Mighty Ape is Australia's entertainment and pop culture superstore, with everything from movies, music, games, toys, books, hobbies and more. Mighty Ape is your one-stop shop for the things that matter most. They constantly have hot deals and exclusive promos. And if you visit their website on the click-through banner on fakeshep.net's homepage, then your purchase will help support Good Movie Monday. Mighty Ape, Australia's entertainment and pop culture superstore.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. You mean to wish me a good morning, or do you mean that it is a good morning whether I want it or not?
Please go away. Let me speak for the love of God.
Welcome to another episode of Good Movie Monday. We are the podcast presented by fakeshemp.net, home of the nerdy cinematic ramblings. And hey, if you found your way here by accident, maybe because you clicked on the wrong thumbnail or something, then why not stick around? We have a fantastic show for you today. We're shaking the dust off our capes and polishing off our coffins because the theme for this week's show is vampires. My name is Glenn Cochran. You can consider me to be the Count Dracula of this occasion. And with me, as always, is the one that you can probably refer to as Redfern, Ben Helwig. G'day, mate.
Hey, how's it going?
Pretty good. Juicy grubs over there?
Yeah, I do love a good grub. As long I'll eat as many grubs as you want, as long as there are no more puns.
I might have a couple more lined up somewhere. But people might be wondering why vampires. That's a good question. That's because the Blu-ray release of the new Aussie fright flick Blood Vessel has just been released. Not only are we giving away copies on this episode, but we'll also be joined by the director Justin Dix and the film's lead star Nathan Phillips. So don't go anywhere. Make sure you hang around for that one. Naturally, we also have regular segments from Jarret, Screen Realm, Adam, and Bonehead Weekly. And before we go any further, a reminder that Good Movie Monday can be found on iTunes, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you get your podcast from, and you can visit fakeshemp.net as well, because that's where all of the stuff that we do gets lumped into one place for your convenience. But Ben, before we sink our teeth into this week's theme, dude, it's happened again. Not only have we got another pun, but no sooner did we record last week's show and Sir Sean Connery passed away at the age of 90. Of course, our regular listeners will know that this show is cursed. There is a curse on it, and you know, celebrities choose to die in between when we record and when the episode drops. This is without a doubt very sad news. Sean Connery, absolute titan, whose name has been referenced throughout this show since it began. It may as well be a drinking game. But 90 years of age, incredible innings, his legacy is huge. What are three films that you would recommend to people who haven't seen a Sean Connery film that probably should?
Oh, that's a good question. Look, I would... Only three. I mean, look, Darby O'Gill and the Little People. Start off with young Sean.
I watched that after you recommended it.
Did you love it?
Oh, yeah. But, like, Scottish man playing Irish man in America.
A fiercely proud Scot playing an Irish guy, but that it was that role in W. O'Gill that got him noticed by Cubby Broccoli, which got him James Bond.
Yes, let's reference the fact that he sings in this film and he can't actually sing.
No, he can sing. He sing well enough for that. But that was, I believe, that was released as a single, that Pretty Irish Girl, and it went to number one in the UK. I have been searching for a 45 of that song since I found out that it got a release.
Well, not only did I watch the film after you recommended it, I also sort of went and did a little bit of deep diving into the production and all that. And he had to take some pretty strong singing lessons for the film because he didn't have a voice. But that single that they released was only thrown at him the day before shooting. He didn't know he had to perform it.
Right.
And they just said, now read the lines and sing, and he had to just do it.
It's funny that he couldn't sing because he got his start in the chorus for like South Pacific or something like that, or like one of those shows which I'm assuming he would have had to sing.
Yeah, but when you're in the chorus, you just blend in with everybody else. Yeah. You know, the conductor's like, you know, there's something quite
off. He just mouths
something
it.
Off here. Yeah, and no one realizes it's fucking Sean up in the back. Yeah,
but did you know the reason? Also, the funny thing was that in prior to that, he had done a film with Lana Turner and they had had an affair. And on the set, when he was on the set of Darby O'Ginn and the Little People, Johnny Stampinato turned up to have words with him, the gangster Johnny Stampinato. If you've seen LA Confidential, there's a bit with both of them in it. And Lana Turner's played by Brenda Back in that film. It's pretty cool. But apparently, Sean Connery took the gun away from Johnny Stampinato and showed him what a real man could do with just his fists. I've made that sound a bit weirder than it should be, but he basically gave Stampinato what for. But that was also why he never worked for Disney again, or at least not in Disney films, because they were like, this guy's got a bit of a dangerous reputation. Like, he's hanging out with, scandalous people that aren't kind of on Disney brand.
And yet he and Walt Disney would play rounds of golf together during those days.
Well, that's, Hollywood is nothing if not hypocritical.
So what other, another two?
So another two, look, I would say, if you haven't seen it, because I haven't talked about it on the show, but I would say give, he did a Western called Chilaco with Brigitte Bardot and I believe Robert Preston, where he helps there's a group of European nobility who have taken a tour, who've come to America and wanted to go on a hunting trip in the middle of Indian territory. And they don't believe that the Indians are good fighters and can stand up to Prussian military superiority. And then, of course, they get attacked and slaughtered by Indians. And Sean Connery basically plays a kind of a tracker in the and a scout for the army who leads them out of Indian territory. It's a pretty awesome film. It's based on a Louis L'Amour novel, which I've also read, and the novel is, as you would expect, much better than the movie, but definitely one worth checking out. And the third film, I would say, just because it was in the early days of the internet, it was my favorite internet meme, but it would be Finding Forrester, because Sean Connery definitely is the man now, dog.
that's such an odd one for me. Like, I like Finding Forrester, but he feels weird in it for me.
Well, as a cantankerous old man, I don't think he's done it better than in Finding Forrester. Like, he's basically playing the same character in Entrapment, except he just doesn't have as cool stuff to do. Like, he's only got the only one good bit in Entrapment is like, no, it's blackmail. Entrapment's when cops do thieves. Like, that's the best. Other than that, and watching Catherine Zeta-Jones do bendy things under laser lights and stuff, like, there's nothing else in that film to really watch, but although I do have to go and revisit it now that I've just kind of got that mental image of the bendy stuff in it, but I do like Finding Forrester. It is great, and it's got like a little, because it's Gus Van Sant, there's a little I can't think of the film, but Matt Damon has a little cameo at the end, and he's
Good Will Hunting,
basically kind of the character from Good Will Hunting, kind of. Pops.
They're very similar
end.
Films in the way they feel, I guess.
Yeah, it's that kind of that indie kind of drama type thing. But I watch that film routinely.
I'm going to throw two out there. I won't really talk about them at length, but two that I think are really they highlight his ability as an actor to sort of stretch himself would be Sidney Lumet's The Hill, which is a war film. Mm-hmm. He has some deep stuff in that, particularly confrontational stuff with the guards of the prison. And the other one would be Outland, Peter Hayes film,
right,
which we mentioned a while ago. And I watched that after talking about it on a previous podcast, not knowing, obviously, he hadn't passed away. So, it just became convenient that I had watched it. It's a really deep performance because, it's a loose remake of High Noon set on Jupiter's moon on a mining colony.
I didn't realize that's what it was.
Yeah, and Peter Boyle plays sort of the other character. But the character of Sean Connery is torn between staying on this facility to get to the bottom of this corruption that's going on, that's, taking lives. And then his family leaves him to go back to Earth because they can't stand the environment anymore. And he's like, well, I've got what way do I go? And he's torn. And you can actually feel that sort of that dilemma in his performance, which is very rare for a Sean Connery performance.
And the menace, like the the menace of the kind of the threat that's hanging over his head the whole time. Like he's was James B. Sicking, he's kind of the dad from Doogie Howser, is his kind of offsider.
Yes.
And he's like, you know, if we stick around, we're going to get killed. Like, and they, and Connery knows this throughout the whole film. Like if he stays, he can't possibly win, but he just can't leave. Like he just can't do it.
Exactly. That interaction with his wife when she's like, we've still got a ticket, it's not too late, and he just can't do it. He's like, no, I've got to stay. It's actually, you know, pretty powerful stuff when you break it down. And I think it's a great performance, and it's just a really cool film. I actually now probably hold that in regards as Peter Hyams' best film as well, which, you know,
it's
done a lot of good stuff.
It's a very good film. I like a lot of Sean Connery's films, but enough. Otherwise, I'll keep talking. There's many more films I could talk about.
Transylvania.
Where is that?
It's over there someplace.
Isn't what it used to be.
Did you see Dracula?
Yeah, when it first came out.
Now the Wolfman's getting electrolysis.
I can go to the beach now.
The vampire's getting lonely.
Tell me you want me to.
And Dr. Frankenstein is getting crazier.
Good, everything hurts.
Rated PG.
It's good, huh?
Okay. Well, anyway, we're not wasting any time here, mate. My interview with Justin Dix is coming up in a moment. But first, let's banter about some Nazi horror flicks, of which there are countless of them. Of course, Justin's movie, Blood Vessel, is set on a Nazi warship at the end of World War II. So how about I read out a bunch of Nazi horror films, and then you maybe can either cherry pick one to talk about or even bring one of your own to the conversation. And we'll consider that to be a recommendation. All right, so we've got The Keep, we've got Shockwaves, we've got Outpost, Overlord, Dead Snow, Blood Rain, Iron Sky, Frankenstein's Army, Ghosts of War, Blood Creek, and then is it Isla She-Wolf of the SS or Isla She-Wolf of the SS?
I think it's Ilsa, isn't it?
Ilsa, that's it. So there we go, just to name some. Are there any there that tickle your fancy?
There's a couple there I haven't seen, and there's a couple there that I really love. Like Dead Snow is, like, as a horror comedy, is a phenomenal film. I loved Overlord. I thought that was really good, and I'm looking forward to actually revisiting that one in the near future. I completely forgot about Frankenstein's Army, and I thoroughly enjoyed that. I went to see the Australian premiere of that at Cinema Nova that a good friend of mine, Zach Hepburn, put on. And I think it was me and two other people in the cinema.
That one caught me right off guard when that came out. I was like, I was drawn to it from the cool cover art and didn't really know what to expect from that one. But yeah, very cool.
It was pretty, pretty awesome. And it was very similar to Overlord. Actually, now that I think about it, it's that same kind of thing. Where, and also, I guess, similar to Wonder Woman. When they, you know, when she, all that Nazi stuff with Wonder Woman in the Wonder Woman movie.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's creating weird things, and he's you know, what's his name from 30 Days of Night is Danny Houston is like himself is like some kind of a weird.
Yeah. Do you know, I think the first Nazi horror film I ever saw when I was pretty young was Shockwaves. And that's always left an impression on me. Remember when the Nazis are all under the water?
Yeah. It's actually like, was it Zombie Lake? The Gene Roland one?
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Where they're all like Nazi zombies and they look really cheesy.
Yeah, could be. And Blood Creek is an interesting one. Like, I wouldn't say it's a great film by any means, but it's a Joel Schumacher film with your favorite, Dominic Purcell. And...
And... You mean Dracula from Blade 3?
It's just like a strange film, and I really dig it. I don't know why. I think Joel Schumacher brings that sort of 8mm vibe to it. You know, that dark production design that he does. Worth a look if you've never seen it. But Dead Snow 2 is another good one.
Yes. I don't... Funnily enough, Dead Snow and Dead Snow 2 kind of blend into one for me. I don't remember...
So... What exactly are you doing? What are you doing over there? Because I'm trying to pad you. Like, I'm trying to pad time here for you because it looks like you're trying to find something.
Sorry. I've got this notice on my computer just popped up saying my disk is almost full. Uh-oh. So I'm trying to find stuff that I can delete so that this thing keeps recording.
There's like a look of panic in your face at the
yeah. I'm like, what's it still says I've got 3 gig. I'm like, this is not gonna take 3 gig.
Because I totally didn't expect to be talking about Shockwaves or Blood Creek, and I'm just thinking, what's he doing? I better throw something at him.
Yeah, like I've got this. I can get rid of all this stuff. This is all those.
All right, so now that all of that that room has been made and you've created some space for yourself there, what Nazi films come to your mind?
Yeah, well, I think I talked about them all. I talked about the ones I was going to talk about.
I mean, we could obviously talk for hours about this kind of subject, but we've got to push on because we do have an interview to play for you. Maybe we can put that in the return to basket, as we do with so many subjects that we never actually return to. We're going to have a compilation episode at some point, mate.
Like, I think that should be our the first show of next year should be. Like literally us going back through all of the shows this year and talking about all the things that we were like, we should talk about that for longer.
Hey, that's a great idea. Pencil it down and we won't do it.
Yeah.
but now, hey, Jarret has been patiently waiting in the wings. So let's have a listen to what he has to say. And then after that, Justin Dix.
Hey, this is Jarret and welcome to PE Class. Now, this week I am dubbing Attack of the Covids because you've got films that were due to come out at the movies but didn't go to the movies because of the COVID. Then you've got the films that did come out of the movies that no one went to see at the movies because of the COVID. And then you've got a whole bunch of DTV filler as always. And no doubt there's something with Eric Roberts or Danny Trejo in there. Let's kick it off with Disney, and they've got Mulan coming out on DVD, Blu-ray, and 4K Ultra HD. This is the 2020 live-action adaptation of their 1998 animated feature. Now, of course, this was due to open in cinemas in March, then it was postponed to July, and then ultimately ended up coming out as a premium rental on their Disney Plus subscriber service. So that means you didn't get it with the basic package, you had to pay a premium fee to rent it. But understandably, Disney had to try and recoup some of the costs of this rather expensive film. Now it's available on physical media, but if you want to try it before you buy, I've heard rumors that it's going to be part of the standard Disney Plus package in December, so you may as well hold out, in my opinion. Then they are also releasing Mulan the Animated Feature on 4K Ultra HD, so this is its 4K debut, and as is the case with most Disney 4K releases of back catalog titles, it is just the 4K disc, does not include the Blu-ray special features, but look, if you're paying less than $25, I don't think you can complain. Then moving on to Universal Sony Pictures Home Entertainment. They've got the Flash Gordon gift set. Now this gift set is from Studio Canal and it's pretty much mirrors the UK gift set that was released a couple months ago. The only exception being it doesn't come with the Queen soundtrack, but it does have the four discs, which are one 4K and three Blu-rays with a whopping amount of features, including the documentary Life After Flash. You've got a booklet, poster, lobby cards, and even an ion transfer. So there's a bunch of cool stuff there. And it's retailing at around about $90. To me, it's probably about $50 or $60. So maybe wait for a sale to try and grab it if you haven't already grabbed the standard release of Flash Gordon. Then a bunch of DTV titles coming out from Universal Sony. I'm going to rush through them. You've got The Silencing, which is actually coming out on DVD and Blu-ray unusually. Jamie Lannister in a DTV actioner. Then they've got a movie coming out called Target Number One with Josh Hartnett. Remember him, the heartthrob from the late 90s, early 2000s? Yeah, that guy. Well, he's back and he's doing DTV films. Then there's The Tax Collector, which is the latest film from David Ayer, and it's hitting home entertainment. And yes, it's that film that Shia LaBeouf got that chess piece tattoo done for. What a fucking idiot. Then there's a movie coming out called Welcome to Sudden Death. Now, this is Michael J. White in this movie. And the actual synopsis reads like it's a remake of the Van Damme film from 95, Sudden Death. Could this be like a new studio low where they do DTV remakes of hit films rather than DTV sequels to films that were hit movies like a decade ago, like Cop and a Half and Kindergarten Cop 2, you know, those type of things. What's better? Like, I'm really, what is better? Is DTV sequels to films from 20 years ago or DTV remakes? I don't know. And then lastly, from Universal Sony Pictures Home Entertainment, in my opinion, probably the most exciting release. This actually out-trumps Flash Gordon. It's Where'd You Go, Bernadette? This is the latest film from auteur Richard Linklater. And unfortunately, it was a case of being a casualty of COVID. It had a very limited theatrical release and seemingly zero coverage. It stars Kate Blanchett, and like anything from Linklater, you have to check it out. I mean, it's fucking Linklater. The guy's a genius. So that's it for me for this week. Until next time, stay physical.
Now, this guy is a jack of all trades. As the founder of Wicked of Oz Studios, he's the writer, director, producer, production designer, makeup artist, and special effects guru, amongst other things. Some films he's worked on that you may know in one capacity or another was Star Wars, Babadook, Storm Warning, The Loved Ones, Red Hill, Charlotte's Web, The Bank Job. I could go on. As we mentioned on the show already, his latest film, Blood Vessel, was released onto Blu-ray last week. It's a pleasure to have him here for a chat. G'day, Justin. How are you?
I'm good. And it's also just coming out on Shudder as well. So
yeah, well, look, it's there's no excuse for people now. They can find it wherever it may be. And the first question I wanted to ask you was, can you believe that a movie you've made is being released onto VHS?
Well, actually, that was I wanted it to be a bit. That was something actually that came out of the blue. Someone contacted me, and I said to my distributor in the US, I said, "Hey, some guy wants to distribute it on VHS." So I said, "Do we want to do that?" And he goes, "Yeah, it's actually just a good marketing thing." And he goes, "You'll get no money out of it. It's fine." He goes, "It's if you want it." And I said, "Well, sure. I mean, as long as I get one." So that's. Yeah. I mean, I just like the whole idea of the tangible holding the thing. Yeah, the VHS. I'll put it on my shelf one day. I love it. Yeah, I've got a VHS of The Dark Crystals that'll go right next to that.
Oh, absolutely. And it's probably all sold out by now. But anyone that does want to try their luck on getting that, it's released through Lo-Fi Video, which is an LA-based production company. But of course, as we said, Umbrella have put it out onto Blu-ray and DVD, and it looks amazing. I've been back to watch it again. First time I saw it was at Monster Fest, and I reviewed it for Screen Realm. Love the film, mate. Love it.
Was it a good review? Was it one of the good ones?
It was one of the good ones.
I have to admit, I don't care about bad reviews. I really don't, because if you got it in the film industry, you've got to have thick skin anyway, because you're putting yourself out there. And I keep saying to people, one of the best reviews I've actually read, well, I don't remember the most of the review. I just remember the last line, and it said, "This is one ship that should have never left port." I thought that was clever. I thought that's clever. So I gave that some kudos. So I don't. It doesn't. Yeah, you know, I know. Some people just don't like bad reviews. To be honest, I really don't care. You got to take the good with the bad. You can't please everybody. I basically made the movie for myself. If I enjoyed it, which I really love it, and I will keep watching it. I've done my job.
Bloody oath, mate. And I guess I don't know if I'm being presumptuous in saying this, but Blood Vessel to me kind of feels like it's almost a companion to your first film, Crawl Space. I guess with the single location, the two-tone color schemes, was that intentional, or is that more a signature of your filmmaking style?
I'm a little bit of a control freak. So kind of, I was the production designer on Crawl Space, but I had a production designer on Blood Vessel, but I kept saying, I sort of said to my DP, I want this extreme red and blues. I don't want everything, like, we can have our dark, but I just want the really sort of a colourful colour palette. I don't really want it to be just dark, dark, dingy, you know. So it was intentional, the colour palette, but it was also, I guess, in a way, if I have it, I don't know if it's meant to be a companion piece, but it's if I have a signature and it looks like one of my films, good, then, you know, kind of I'll run with it. Because, I mean, you know, the next one I do, I'll probably have, we've already done a promo for it, and it's kind of got the same sort of vibe as well. Yeah, just like the same colours and, you know, sort of, it's, yeah. So I guess there's a thing there. I don't know.
I love that. I mean, the blue and the red, I almost felt like I was wearing those old-fashioned 3D glasses.
I never thought of it that way, but yeah, true.
That's cool. So I guess in terms of influence, there's a lot of influence going on here. What was one of the main driving forces behind the creative process as far as, you know, leaning on certain films of the past for nostalgic reasons?
I try not to necessarily like copy things of the past, but at the same time, I am obviously influenced by the past, and I have like massive affinity for anything John Carpenter. He's one of my favorites. And like just Big Trouble in Little China and The Thing and Halloween, or just any of those things, anything he's done really. Like there's one called Prince of Darkness I really love, which a lot of people know. Mm-hmm. yeah, I just like anything John Carpenter. I just think he has a, I said to someone the other day, you put a film on, and if you didn't tell me it was John Carpenter, I could tell you it was John Carpenter, just because I can recognize his style. And there is just certain things about his movie, and I did talk to Nathan about The Thing a lot. I said, this is an ensemble. I said, you're my Kurt Russell. I said, you know, I kind of want this to basically be a bit of a, you know, very much an ensemble piece, not a one particular, you know, I didn't want him to necessarily stand out so much, even though it's very hard to contain Nathan. But at the same time, I just wanted it to be very much that you didn't know who was going to go next, you know, so it's one of those things. But I am very influenced by films definitely of the 80s. In fact, the next one that we're doing is probably going to be, it's set in 1985, because I'm trying to go, well, you know what, I might as well embrace it.
Fantastic. Look, I don't expect you to go into in any detail with that, but is it set in Australia or is it an American set piece?
No, it's an American set piece. It's just trying to be, who knows whether it's going to go ahead though. I mean, like, I've got a couple of things boiled, so, you know, but there's a few things that are sort of like me saying whatever film I'm doing next may not be the next film I do. So, you know, there's no,
that's true.
Let's just say that what I'm doing is I'm going through all my monsters. I've realized what I'm doing is I'm basically obviously a bit in special effects, and I have a massive affinity for monster movies. So I call them, you know, I'm doing creature features. In Crawl Space, I did like sort of a mutated things and psychic things and mutated gorilla or whatever. So, you know, and I had an alien, blood vessels, vampires. There's two films. There's either going to be, one's going to be either like zombie cowboy movie, or the other one that I have, which is going to be like sort of like Army of Darkness, like you got back there, or the other one's kind of like every single creature I can possibly imagine. It's just like the Grimm's Brothers fairy tales brought to life. So I'm kind of just got with werewolves and everything. So I'm kind of going through just my, I think I'm just trying to, I just want to make every movie that has been of a creature. You know what I mean? I kind of feel like once I get it out of my system, then I can move on to other things.
Mate, I've always said that fans make the best filmmakers, you know, when it comes to genre.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I've always wanted to make a werewolf movie, so that will, I mean, that is possibly my next one, but we're not sure yet. But again, awesome. which way we lean, but you know.
Yeah, right. Well, given your background in practical effects and, you know, you splash the real blood across the screen, it's much more effective. It's easier to connect with as a viewer. Is there ever an urge to sort of concede to digital effects just for convenience?
No, I don't. But the funny thing is, weirdly enough, Blood Vessel, I didn't feel had enough blood. I feel I didn't have enough gore. It's after the fact, I was kind of going, yeah, I really should have, that first guy that the vampire killed, he really should have ripped his head off. We should have just ripped his head off. Just had really gratuitous. And I kind of like, it was after the fact, I went, you know, and we obviously didn't film it, so I couldn't do it. Yet I've seen reviews and things where they say, you know, oh my God, it's really, you know, full of blood and everything. I'm going, really? I don't think it's bloody enough. So I kind of felt like I should have gone a bit further. But I, as far as digital goes, I've always said, one of my sayings is don't default to digital, you know, practical where possible. I still believe that because I think it looks more real. Saying that, depending on which film I go, one of them I'm doing is I'm doing complete Sin City style, all on green screen. I'm completely going digital. Saying that, I'm still doing practical effects, you know, practical creatures and lots of stuff. Just using Unreal Engine for backgrounds and stuff like that. So.
Well, I guess what those critics might have been thinking when they talked about all the blood is that you just splash the screen with red. It's that color scheme that maybe sort of tricked them. It's that Richard Donner school of blood, you know, put red in the frame and they'll make up the rest.
Yeah, quite possibly. I mean, I don't think it's that gory at all, to be honest. And maybe, I just don't think it is. And if maybe I'm just desensitized to it or something. Yeah, I mean, again, I look at things where, obviously, there's a lot of influence. Even the captain with his throat torn out, that is completely the thing. You know, it's them discovering sort of like the mystery that's abound on the ship, and you know, rather than the Norwegian camp. So it's very, I can see the influences, obviously, but that's just because that's the sort of the shit I love. You know.
Yeah, well, they're the kind of things that us, you know, horror fans latch onto. Like, we love that. You know, we don't think of it in any other way than delightful.
It's like Tarantino. He just like copies all his favorite things. So, you know, like, he doesn't copy them, but he burrows
pastiche.
And he definitely, you know, uses some shots and things like that. So I'm kind of, I guess I'm doing the same sort of thing, but I'm just going through my John Carpenter phase. You know.
So tell me about the ship itself. You shot it on a real ship docked in Melbourne. What were the benefits of being on a real ship, or more so, what were the difficulties of being on locations like that?
Well, there's both. The benefits of the it's a ship, and you can kind of point the camera anywhere. You know, you don't have edge of frame or anything like that. You can kind of just point the camera anywhere. It looks amazing. The only thing is, it was looked too brand new, so we had to kind of dirty it up and make it look kind of crappy. And we actually ended up building a bunch of sets over the kitchen set to make it look less modern. And then afterwards, we shot some we did shoot some stuff in my studio, but we ended up building. I built them myself. It's a couple of sets. And I went, man, I could have probably shot the whole film this way, really. I didn't have to film the whole thing on a ship, which I'm glad we did, because I go down there. Actually, I went down there on the weekend and just walked around it with actually one of my cast members, the guy who plays the German Huss. And we were walking around it and reminiscing and go, oh, there's our ship. And we were kind of, God, we missed the ship. Yeah, because it was kind of like a bit of a going to summer camp, you know. It wasn't summer, it was winter. It was freezing and raining. But it was our ship, and you know, you get, I understand now that term sea legs. Didn't know what it meant before I got on the ship. Once you're on it all day and then you get off on shore and you're going, whoa, you know, swaying back and forth, you realize, okay, yeah, I know what the sea legs means now.
Yeah, totally. This is probably covered on some of the special features on the Blu-ray. I haven't had a chance to explore all of them yet, but can you give us a little insight on the secret of those early shots in the life raft or even the ship itself throughout the film when you pan up and you get this wide shot of the ocean? You know, where do miniatures come in and real photography sort of blend?
Well, basically it's because it's just like, that is the thing. We had the ship, it's docked there. It's been docked there for 30 something years. Doesn't move. And unfortunately you've got a wharf, you've got a city of Melbourne, you've got yachts all around it. It's very hard to not get them in shot. And a lot of the time we did get them in shot, so we had to obviously edit around that. So to get those wides that you really want to, that you really sort of the film deserves of the film, the sense of isolation, any way to do it was a miniature. And I mean, you know, we didn't think we thought the miniature would hold up, but didn't know it would hold up as well as it did in a lot of scenes where when you have a miniature, you can just film the crap out of it for like, you know, a few hours. And we just got so much value out of it. We were, and obviously it just worked really, really well, because obviously every time you turn the camera off in a digital effect, it costs you money. Not on practical effects. You can turn the camera on and off as many times you want, and it's all gravy. So that was like, I 100% knew we were going to do a miniature ship right from the beginning, because I'd done a miniature sub before, and it was like bigger than the one we actually made for the blood vessel. And I knew it worked at that scale, six scale, and I went, yeah, that works fine. It'll work, no problems. So I didn't bother really utilizing the real ship, except for when we had the cast having to climb it or kind of go up to the side of it and things like that. There was no real point, because it was very hard to get a wide frame on it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm also a massive fan of Nathan Phillips, who obviously is more or less your headliner in this one. He's got a real knack for bouncing between sort of Aussie larrikin performances and then really powerful, emotionally charged performances. And I think he worked both of them quite well in this film, and he produced it. What's it like to collaborate with him?
Oh, great. Because what happened is he's a massive believer in the project. He's like, me and Nathan have a lot of the same sensibilities. We love the same sort of things. We have the same references. Like, we probably wouldn't know from just like putting us both together. He's very earthy and sort of hippie, and I'm surfy and I'm not. But at the same time, a lot of things we love. We love the same novelist, Matthew Riley. We're both big fans of his. We're just there's a lot of common ground there. And so we get along really well. And we also, he knew exactly what I wanted with the character. I said, you know, I want an Australian Kurt Russell. I said, that's what I want. You know, I said, I want this, I don't want you to be funny, but you can be, have that Australian larrikinism that's just bring it in, you know, bring it in sort of like at a sort of a lower level. It's not like, ba-dum-chum, you know, it's not like one of those jokes. But no, he got it completely. And he embraced the whole thing about being an Anzac. Loved it, you know, really, because his grandfather was an Anzac and all sort of stuff. And he was just really, he was totally into representing Australian soldiers, because he doesn't feel like they're being represented. You know I mean, and especially one being pretty much the hero, you know. So he really liked that. He loved the idea of that. And it was great. And also it was really, working with Nathan was great in a producing capacity, because on a film, and a lot of people don't know that, but there's many different producers, right? Let's call it six producers, really, only maybe, my other producers probably get mad at this, there's only about three of them that really do things. And like, so I was definitely doing all the creative sort of stuff, organizing a whole bunch of things, locations, special effects, blah, blah, blah. My business partner, Steve, was doing a lot of the contracting, finance, and all that sort of stuff. And Nathan was also helping with every part, like with catering, with making sure we had sort of vans to transport people with. He was even helping with auditions, just with everything. You know what I mean? Like, he was just wherever he was needed, he'd sort of plug a hole. So, and that was great because, and it was just really good because he was so invested in the project.
Yeah, awesome. I hope you guys do get a chance to work again because it does feel like it's a natural thing.
Oh, no, I have intentions to work with him very much again, you know what I mean? And because I kind of know what he can deliver. I mean, I've always been a fan of, I've worked with Nathan a couple of times before in the past. Like I worked with him on a movie called,
Dying Breed?
Yeah, Dying Breed. And then we worked together on Hunters. And it was on Hunters we started saying, oh man, we really just need to work together properly, you know, like properly. And and from that, basically, you know, we always had sort of had the thing to talk in mind. But it wasn't until when I saw what was that movie that he did, the one with the post-apocalyptic one?
Oh, These Final Hours.
These Final Hours. I saw that, and I think I messaged him. I messaged him or called him or something and said, seriously, best performance you've ever done. I really thought that was just it's a stellar performance. I think I said something like, that shows me you're an actor. You know what I mean? Like, I mean, yeah. no offense to any of the other roles he's done before, but I went, nah, he's acting, man. That was really good. So, yeah.
I totally agree. And I hold that in regard to being one of the top 20 great Australian films of all time. It's phenomenal.
Oh, look, I really agree. It's just really amazing. It's just, again, great performances and everything. So, and it's funny with Nathan because he can kind of, like, he grows a beard and he ages like, probably hates this, he ages like 20 years. Because, like, that film wasn't done that long ago and, like, he was clean shaven and he looked like a young bloody surfer. So, like, he can bounce between different sort of, like, demographic as well. So, yeah, that's why he's quite versatile, yeah.
Yeah, a bit of a chameleon for sure. Well, anyway, like I said, Blood Vessel is available on Blu-ray and DVD and digital through Umbrella Entertainment and on Shudder. Go buy a copy, go watch it, and keep listening to the show because we do have copies of that to give away thanks to Umbrella. Justin, it's been an absolute pleasure chatting with you, mate. Congrats on a kick-ass horror flick. I've had heaps of fun with the film. I've watched it 3 times now, actually, and really appreciate you taking the time.
I'll just get up. You're all I've ever wanted, but I'm terrified of you. Sick, my castle may be haunted, but I'm terrified of you. I've cast my spell on millions, but I'm terrified of you. Baby, I do this from the ceiling, but I'm terrified of you. I wait my whole life to bite the right one. Then you come along and that freaks me out. So I'm frightened. Ooh, Dracula's run. Never ran from no one, but I'm terrified of you. See, my heartbeat is a slow one, but I'm terrified of you. I've been around for ages, but I'm terrified of you. Done my thing across the stage, but yet I'm terrified of you. I wait my whole life to fight the right one. Then you come along and that freaks me out. So I'm frightened. Dracula's wedding. You know I'm terrified. You know I'm terrified. You know I'm terrified. Shh. Here she comes. Stake, go back, choice of words, but I'm not the gun. Shot the silver bullets, and I can count 1, 2, 3. Plus I make great peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. Van Helsing. For richer or poorer, through sickness. Thank you.
any excuse to play some Outkast is fine by me. That was Dracula's Wedding. I think it's a perfect footnote to that conversation with Justin Dix. Very cool stuff. And we do have Blood Vessels lead actor Nathan Phillips coming up, who some of you would probably know from Wolf Creek or even Snakes on a Plane, amongst so many other things. In fact, he was in one of my favorite Aussie films, These Final Hours. An incredible performance there. So hang tight, he is coming up. But first, let's get this week's movie news from Screen Realm, and then we'll talk about vampires.
What's going on, everybody? It's Guillermo here again from ScreenRealm.com, Australia's favorite entertainment website covering all things movies and television, kicking off with an Orphan prequel. That's right, 11 years after the release of horror thriller Orphan, comes word that the prequel is now being filmed. Orphan First Kill is set to star Julia Stiles, whose many credits include four Jason Bourne movies, Hustlers and Silver Linings Playbook, among many others. Interestingly though, the original film star Isabel Furman, who played the, in quotation marks, orphan, is reprising her role as Esther. Deadline broke the news, reporting that the plot will follow Lena Klemmer as she orchestrates a brilliant escape from an Estonian psychiatric facility and travels to America by impersonating the missing daughter of a wealthy family. But Lena's new life as Esther comes with an unexpected wrinkle and pits her against the mother, who will protect her family at all costs. As for how Furman, now at 23 years of age, will be embodying the character again, the filmmakers are reportedly using a combination of forced perspective shooting and a world-class makeup team. Orphan First Kill is being directed by William Brent Bell, known for Stay Alive, The Devil Inside, The Boy, and Brahms The Boy 2. In more horror news, Insidious 5 has officially been greenlit, with one of the franchise's stars at the helm. Patrick Wilson, who starred in Insidious and Insidious Chapter 2, is set to direct the fifth film in the horror film series. As was announced at the first Blumfest, Wilson will be directing and starring alongside Ty Simpkins, who will be back as Dalton Lambert, son to Wilson's Josh Lambert. The film is to be a sequel, reuniting the Lamberts 10 years after the last installment and following Dalton as he heads to college. Who knows what the demons of Astral Plane The Further will have in store this time around. Aussie franchise creator Lee Whannell came up with the story, and the script has been penned by Scott Teams, whose credits include Rectify, this year's Michael Shannon starring The Quarry, Netflix's Narcos Mexico, and the upcoming horror sequel Halloween Kills. Our writer Adam Fleet had two movie reviews go up in the past week. His House, a Netflix horror film that he called a harrowing horror story with a focus on the refugee perspective, 4 out of 5 stars. And Alone, a survival thriller that he called a skillfully crafted edge-of-your-seat thriller, which also got 4 out of 5 stars. Be sure to check out both those reviews. Both those films are worth tracking down. One's on Netflix, the other is available to rent on Foxtel and Fetch. And finally, we have two awesome giveaways on the website right now. The horror thriller Apartment 1BR and the new Scott Adkins action movie Seized. Both of them are available to own right now, and we're giving away 10 DVD copies of each film, so jump on Screen Realm, head to the win page and enter. That about does it for me, guys. Thanks so much for having me. As usual, ScreenRealm.com for your latest movie, TV news, trailers, all that jazz. I'm out of here.
Welcome to Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. This week's topic, gentlemen, is
rodent films. Because why not?
Yeah, I mean, we talked about whether is it a mouse, whether it's a rat, and Chad said, let's do rodents.
Well, by the way, and we should do rodents because we need to have respect for them, because eventually they will be our overlords. Disney already owns Marvel, Star Wars. Hell, the rodents.
On our animated rodent films, one of my favorite ones is a Gore Verbinski film. And actually, Chad and I were talking about this, as far as, if you don't know who Gore Verbinski is, he's the director of Made Pirates of the Caribbean. But my three favorite Gore Verbinski films are right up here with either The Weatherman and Rango, going back and forth, and then Mouse Hunt. Mouse Hunt is a lot of fun. Stars Nathan Lane. It was a kind of a modest hit in the 90s. The mouse doesn't talk. Mouse is a huge character. It's the last movie with a character actor on here we've talked about several times, William Hickey, who we just have Debbie Rochon on our previous episode, who talked about working with William Hickey. Check out Mouse Hunt. I think it's one that probably doesn't get a lot of play anymore, but I really liked it.
I'm going to go with one of the staples from my childhood. I am a big Don Bluth fan.
Ah.
So I have to talk about The Secret of Nim. Dark animated film. If you haven't seen it, it's about a mother mouse who has a sick child and other children, and the area that they're moving in, they have to evacuate and they can't because the child is sick, and she is seeking a secret magical amulet that will help her get out, get her family out before they are doomed. That is a bad description of that movie.
No, well, I haven't seen it in a long time.
But it is very, the owl scene in that movie is extremely traumatizing.
It's like the last, it's one of those films like The Last Unicorn. If you're of a certain age, it traumatized you visually. Dude, also, I had the lunchbox when I was in grade school, the old school metal lunchbox with the secret in the end. Wish I still had it.
And, you know, honestly, it didn't scar me any. Deadly silence on a podcast.
Yep, there you go. All
and
right,
James, what do you got?
I have to go with, and those of you that know me know I'm going to do this. I have to
go with
the greatest rat of all time. There's even a song about what a great rat he is. And I, of course, refer to Vincent Price voicing Ratigan in The Great Mouse Detective. Chad, I ask you, name me three other rats that have songs about how they are the greatest criminal mastermind.
Are also voiced by Vincent Price.
Give me one other Vincent Price voiced rat that says he's the greatest.
Hold on, let me look up songs about current political leaders.
oh, timely.
Dump the Trump, blah, 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 blah.
Anyway, yeah, no, so if you've never seen The Great Mouse Detective, it's one that I wish Disney would do a direct-to-video sequel for.
But who's going to do the voice now?
Maurice LaMarche, that did Vincent Van Gogh and the Scooby-Doo reboot where they brought back Vincent Van Gogh. If you're going to do it, you better get him. By the way, we would love to have him on the show if he happens to some reason hear this.
Oh, quick, off topic. Screw you, Disney, for replacing Maurice LaMarche in Frozen 2. Go to hell.
Who is he the voice of?
The dad.
Oh, I didn't know.
But yes, Maurice LaMarche could do it. But yes, no, I love Sherlock Holmes. So obviously, I used to watch it with my dad as a kid. I watched every version, Basil Rathbone, all of them. So when there was a Disney film version of Sherlock Holmes with Basil of Baker Street, based on the book series, which I have the original books over there now.
Oh my God.
But yes, Ratigan is Moriarty of the rat world.
And with that, thank you so much. I know it was just a weird sentence to hear. That's been our favorite rat movies or rotten films. Bonehead Weekly Fun Size. What am I supposed to do? Are we supposed to hold this pose?
Are we freeze framing?
Can we do like the not the naked gun, but the, police squad.
Ah, those boneheads from Kentucky, they are, of course, in the USA. And, well, if that anticipated Second Civil War breaks out at any moment, then Lord help those boneheads. Great stuff from them, as always, and I'll be honest with you, I didn't give them any kind of lead-in time to record a special vampire segment to tie in with today's show, so why not rodent movies? They had that one banked, and I thought I'd use that. Anyway, their own podcast, Bonehead Weekly, features a who's who of film folk, so go ahead and throw Joe, Chad, and James a like and a follow. Give them some love too. And before them was Guillermo with all of this week's movie news and updates from Screen Realm. Show them some love while you're at it. ScreenRealm.com is where you go. But Ben, vampires.
It's like I'm in the studio with the Count from Sesame Street.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. And as you would know, I've said this on the show before, maybe before your tenure, but Roman Polanski's Fearless Vampire Killers would have to be one of my favorite vampire films of all time. Possibly one of the best damn looking vampire films I've ever seen. Those opening scenes with Abronius and Alfred on the cart in the snow. It's absolutely gorgeous. Have you seen that one?
I saw it when I was about 13. I borrowed it from Video Flash. It was another one of those movies that I convinced my grandmother that my parents would be totally cool with me watching when I was like 13. They would not have been. And watching it, and so much of it went over my head.
Yeah.
It's crying out for a rewatch.
It is a perfect balance between actual horror and slapstick comedy. It's got both.
You see, I don't think I picked up on any of the horror stuff in it. Like, I just, all I remember in that it was like watching a like a vampire version of Some Mothers Do Have It, mainly with Roman Polanski.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of cool stuff in there. I really just the production value of it is incredible to me. But I tell you what, same deal as before. Let me reel off a bunch of vampire films that I really dig, some unusual ones, and then maybe either take your pick from those or bring one to the table. Razorblade Smile is one back in the 90s that I really dug, a real sort of indie kind of vampire film. Kronos, which is Guillermo del Toro. Thirst, the Aussie film. Lesbian Vampire Killers with James Gordon and Martin, the George Romero film. That's a great one. And of course, we can't ignore Life Force, the Tobey Hooper film. I think that's pretty cool too. Any of those struck a chord or maybe have something else up your sleeve?
I like all of those films, but for me, I think you've gone too new in all of them.
Right.
I think if you want to watch an awesome vampire film, you can't go past the Christopher Lee Peter Cushing classic Dracula AD 1972.
Oh my god,
which I really love this film. Not only is it a Hammer Dracula film, but it's the one that they set in the 70s, which, to be honest with you, I always thought it was more 60s because it's very 60s, swinging 60s kind of London set, but they did it to kind of capture young audiences after kind of the gothic horror stuff had started to slowly lose lessening popularity, but it does feature the stunning sister Kate Stephanie Beecham. That's I don't care if you've seen The Bitch or The Nightcomers or are fans of Dallas. For me, Stephanie Beecham is always going to be Sister Kate from the sitcom Sister Kate with Jason Priestley pre-Beverly Hills 90210. And Carolyn Monroe, the gorgeous Carolyn Monroe. And it's all about, it's kind of ridiculous, like a descendant of Dracula's offsider. Revives the dead count. The count is killed by Peter Cushing and a wagon wheel at the start of the film. And then he's revived thanks to an occult ritual by this disciple's descendants, whose last name in the film is actually Dracula spelled backwards because they're just that clever. And Stephanie Beecham is the descendant of Van Helsing. She's, I think, Jessica Van Helsing.
Oh, my God.
And her great-grandfather, Peter Cushing, or grandfather Peter Cushing, who's also a descendant of the original Van Helsing. Naturally, you can't be. They could not both be descendants.
Yes.
But I tell you what, it is a phenomenal film, but the best special effect in it is the magical tape that Stephanie Beecham uses to keep her breasts ensconced in her dress during the kind of sacrifice scenes. There's scenes where she, just breathing, she looks like she's going to pop out.
Is she?
And there is nothing.
Is she wearing?
I would have loved more.
Is she wearing a Wonder Bra?
I don't think Stephanie Beecham needed a Wonder Bra.
A Wonder Bra.
Yeah. Wunderbar. I don't think she needed it.
How does it hold up as a horror film?
I mean, I don't know. Like, is there like a lot of horror films? Like, for me, I'm a big jump scare guy. Like, they work on me all the time, and I'm a big guy. So when I jump, everyone two rows around me, they know it.
It's hilarious.
And there's none of that. They're not really. None of the Christopher Lee Dracula films were like scary, but
when I say horror, like, how about the gothic themes? Are they really prevalent? Like, or is it more a kitschy kind of thing?
Oh, it's very. This is probably the kitschiest of those Christopher Lee.
Yeah, right.
Dracula movies, just because it's set in that kind of in a modern setting. It's no, like something like was it Satan? Is it Satan Rides Out? Is that what it's called? Like the kind of the more.
Mm.
The more culty folk horror type ones of the same era have a lot more kind of that kind of stuff in it. This is a lot more kind of fun and kitsch, and it's very similar, I guess, for me, in kind of tone to what's it called? Not Death Cheaters. What's that? The motorcycle gang who It's got a couple of names, and I just can't think of it. Psychomania. Psychomania is one of the titles.
Awesome. I'll throw one into the discussion that I actually watched again recently in preparation for this episode. I was trying to think, what's a vampire film that probably few people know about but would be interested in? And there's one called The Wisdom of Crocodiles, which was released in 1998, and it starred Jude Law, Timothy Spall, Kerry Fox, and Alina Lowenson. I think that's how you pronounce her surname. And she was also
from all the Hal Hartley movies.
And she was also in the other vampire film, Nadja, which was produced by David Lynch.
Yeah, with Martin Donovan in it. Yeah.
Yeah, which we've talked about.
I didn't know Crocodile Tears was a vampire film.
Wisdom of Crocodiles.
Wisdom of Crocodiles, sorry. Crocodile Tears, yeah.
Yeah, and in America it was released as Immortality. That was the international title.
Right.
But this one...
To be honest, I thought you were going to say Forsaken Desert Vampires.
Dude, I am still working on old Jonathan to get him on the show. Believe me, I am at it.
Yeah, right. Awesome.
And I will make that happen. So I've avoided talking about Forsaken because I know damn well we're going to have a whole episode about it.
Yeah.
But The Wisdom of Crocodiles is a strange horror thriller that blends the usual sort of romance and sex stuff that you find in vampire films, but it also infuses a police procedural element. Jude Law plays a guy that... He seduces all these women, and actually over a prolonged time. So he gets to the point that he proposes to them, they become engaged, and then this one moment of passion, he always kills them. Like, and it's like he's a vampire that only needs to feed every so often, and when he does, it's a frenzy. And, you know, he right. gets these women in the absolute passion, you know, of love, and then just absolutely wipes them clean. Like, it's right. really brutal, but... It's well made, but the director went on to pretty shit stuff like, you know, Steven Seagal and Wesley Snipes DTV crap. So it's a shame that this, you know, this talent that made this really, really effective and provocative film went on to pretty average stuff.
Yeah. I mean, thinking about it, it's funny how, like, when you suggested this topic and when we were talking about it and thinking about it, I was struggling to kind of think of cool vampire films that I really liked. And now I'm thinking, well, I completely forgot about Near Dark and From Dusk Till Dawn. And, you know, Dracula 2000.
Yes. And
Dracula 3000.
I feel like they're just the obvious go-tos. And I was sort of trying.
Bordello of Blood.
I was trying. Yeah, Bordello of Blood. Oh, my God. I was trying to.
Tales from the Crypt presents Bordello of Blood.
I was trying to think of the more obscure ones going into this. But you're right. Yeah. Like, you know, once again, let's just file that in the basket and we'll not talk about it again. I feel like we've had a vampire discussion somewhere along the lines already on this show. I just can't pinpoint where. But nevertheless, Bordello of Blood, mate, there's an episode in that. I'll get what's his name? John Cassier on the show. And
can we get Erica Eleniak on the show?
Yeah.
Is that something that we
Why
can
not?
Do?
Why not? And we can talk about her career.
Yeah, Chasers and Baywatch. I know we're not supposed to cover TV on this show. But if we get Erica Eleniak, surely we can talk about Baywatch.
We'd have to. And let's not forget Under Siege, because there's a great cake moment in that.
Oh, there's a... Yeah. The greatest cake moment in cinema, I would argue.
I could easily fall down that rabbit hole, but I don't want to.
I'd love to fall down her rabbit hole. I don't know what you're talking about. See? Uncle Ben can do the puns as well.
And with that, we have a conversation with Nathan Phillips to get to. So all you need to know about what you're about to hear is that Nathan actually lives rather remotely and has fairly average phone reception. So if his audio cuts out a little bit, that would be why. I keep that in mind. But without further delay, it's a pretty awesome conversation. Here's Nathan Phillips. Hey, mate. Great to talk to you. Thanks for swinging by.
Yes, lovely to see you again.
Congrats on Blood Vessel, mate. Finally released on Blu-ray. What a rad movie.
Yep, she's a corker.
So you and Justin you've worked a few times together over the years on Dying Breed and Hunters, if I've got my facts right. I guess it's safe to say you guys have a pretty good working relationship.
Yeah, we have a really deadly rapport. He's a fanboy. He loves cinema. His favorite holiday is Halloween, not Christmas. Or anything. He's an avid, you know, like I said, fanboy of the genre itself, horror. And he's worked with, you know, George Lucas, obviously. He's Justin. But what I love about Justin is he has enthusiasm. It's like, how long's a piece of string? Like, that guy just lives and breathes cinema. hidden, and he's quite an expert in his fields of special effects. And he's just a really wonderful man to be around, and he treats everyone with kindness, and he's just a wonderful leader. And he's getting better at directing, obviously. But he's just a fantastic person to be around, and that it's infectious. And he makes you enjoy your day of work and enjoy your day of play more so.
What a difference it makes to be a fanboy first, hey?
Yeah, you've got a bit of authenticity about it, you know. He has his, you know, he clearly, Blood Vessel's a homage to many of his favorite directors and even stylized shots. And he wanted to make a vampire movie that was, you know, quite different and you know, no CGI and just all real effects, and you know, working with really talented makeup artists, and everyone that works with him loves him. So it was a no-brainer for me because the concept worked. You know, it's when you have a tight budget, and I helped him raise the money. We talked about this early, and it was filming in Melbourne, where I'm originally from, and in Williamstown, where I wasn't far, you know, born away. My grandparents are from there, and it just felt so right. And and to actually film on an actual ship that served in World War II, I knew, like, working in film over 22 years now, I kind of know when things are going to work and where I want to put my energy. Otherwise, I'd put my energy into being in the outdoors and working the land and being of service. But I do love working with great people, and I'm happy to only work when I want to work now. So Justin, yeah, he had a great concept, one location really, and it was really quite advantageous in a lot of ways. But he pulled it off, and I mean, he worked tirelessly. He worked, you know, just to the bone. And he always had a smile on his face. Like, I kid you not, you know. Then the hours, like, directing, producing, he'd be there scrubbing down the ship, getting the blood and all the effects off to help the people. You know, like, he went to such lengths to show his passion. And you know, to be working with him so closely, with choosing the other actors, and producing the movie with him, I felt a lovely bit of an onus, a responsibility, accountability, and to kind of bring that old Kurt Russell vibe, you know, you want, like, to have American, like, to really play it all fit, like, because my, like, great grandfathers were Ratzer to Brook. So to be able to play, and how, when I've read, like, Peter Fitzsimmons' Ratzer to Brook, for instance, the letters from the Anzacs, they always were in, you know, they were in such dire straits, yet they still had a sense of humor. And I love that we kept that with the character of Sinclair. And then just to be able to work with the other actors closely and the script, and he's not too precious about, it's not Shakespeare for him. And if you just make it sing, let's make it work. And so, yeah, it was a very fun experience, except for being on a very small ship and you do hit your head a lot and you trip over, you know.
I was about to ask you about shooting in the warship. It must have been challenging to say the least. But speaking of the sense of humor, your character, I think, has probably the greatest line in the entire film, and that's that reveal when you see the vampire for the first time, and it's a simple "get fucked." I don't think I've laughed that hard in a long time. You said it with such conviction, mate.
I just did that on the day, felt right. And that's the best thing about me, Justin. Yeah, he gives me a bit of rope. He really allows me to flesh out some ideas, and I like to be instinctive, and I don't like to do too many takes. I think the magic's there, you know, and as long as you're prepared, and yeah, that's where the magic lies, you know. It's in that space of play.
Yeah, right. And I'm thinking, like, vampires, Nazi warship, badass character, do you even need to read the script? It kind of has "hell yes" written all over it.
Yeah, well, yeah, exactly. I'm like, yeah, zombies and like vampires and Nazis. It's a motley concoction, you know. And that's the thing with a good concept. You've got to have all the ingredients for alchemy to make gold if you're missing one. And I really believed in Justin. It's only his second directorial kind of thing. And he's only going to go strength from strength. So I really hope the Australian film industry backs him, or people back him and see his talent. And so he really is like my Ridley Scott of Australia, you know.
Yeah, totally. So over the years, you've been on the same credit scrolls as people like Samuel L. Jackson, Rachel Taylor, Lee Whannell, Matthew McConaughey, Oscar Isaac. But dude, now Dave Hughes, you've arrived.
Is he? Well, he's a mate, so I got him. I got him to do me a favor because I've done favors going on his radio show and TV show. So yeah, I was really, really stoked to get Hughesy on. You know, just for a, and it's he was nervous, poor bugger. He was a nervous Nelly to say the least. He clams up. He's like, what's yeah. And he's just, you know, he's good value. He's Hughesy. Hughesy. Mate. Character. Motivation.
Well, speaking of fantastic, colourful characters as well, you've also worked with Steady Eddie. Excuse the digression for a moment, but, like, talk about a fitting title, Under the Radar. That's a great little flick.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty funny. Chloe Maxwell, I think she won a AFI for that performance.
Yeah, it's just one of those films that I think it sort of it holds up really well when you watch it, you know, all these years later.
All right. Yeah, I can't say I've seen it for a long time. Like, that's the blast in the past, that. I mean, I was a puppy then.
You were. Do you look back on any of your movies like that?
Well, You and Your Stupid Mate was a really funny one with Angus Samson. I loved that.
It's Mark Gracie.
Yeah, I wish it was a bit more, like, gung-ho, a bit more, went a bit bigger and a bit more, you know, but it was a good concept. It just, it kind of fell short. But I'm catching up with Rose Byrne tomorrow. She's in town doing the film. And I'd done Takeaway with Mark Gracie just before that. And that was a really fun movie. You know, Stephen Curry and Vince Colosimo and, you know, just Rose Byrne, just a top budge, just a real good laugh, you know, Kevin Harrington.
One of the other ones I wanted to quickly talk about, and I think possibly the greatest performance you've ever given would be These Final Hours. I think it's arguably one of the greatest Australian films of all time. Do you have a performance in general that you look back on, or even a film that you hold high above the rest?
Australian Rules.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, that Australian Rules.
It's a great film.
That was my best, like my first film straight out the gates, and it was based on a book, based on a true story, and being, you know, very, frustrated with the way we've treated the Indigenous and the originals, you know, and just it was right at that time when you started to see Australian cinema recognising it. Mm-hmm. You had a spate of with The Tracker. So I was nominated against David Gulpley that year when he won for The Tracker. No better bloke to see win. You know, I came from the West. I kind of fell into it. And Australian Rules was my bread and butter. I had an amazing dramaturg with David Field. He's an Australian icon. And that's how I cut my teeth. And it took 10 years till I felt that again, and that was These Final Hours. So if I ever say my two favorite films, it was These Final Hours, clearly, and just because, again, the subject matter was very timely. The story was powerful and made your mind kind of really turn over, and it made your heart really pump and made your gut kind of like churn. So Australian Rules gave me a lot of experience as a young man to really see the world for what it is, and Australia for what it is, and since then, I haven't looked back really, but I definitely prefer, I like the popcorn, and you know, I like entertainment, and I think comedy is great medicine. I mean, I'd love to see everyone laughing more, but I do think if we can, the power of film to be universal storytelling and pass on the human qualities of a good ethos and a pathos and just a great hubris of characters, you know, it can be a very pivotal, powerful platform. So if I wasn't doing it on the camera, I'd be doing it by the fire. Put it that way.
I do. Over the last 12 months, I've done a lot of work for the Scarefest convention in America, and I introduced them to These Final Hours through a video segment that I was doing and blew their minds. It's a really universal story. It's fantastic.
Yeah, no, but the one I get noticed for still and freak people out is Wolf Creek. Everywhere I go, especially when I go bush, people are like, especially when people want to get like hitchhikers, I pitch up hitchhikers, and oh my god, I've had some funny experiences where people are like, "You look like from Wolf Creek," like they grab the door and get out the car, you know.
People listening right now can't see that you actually look like you've stepped right out of Wolf Creek.
I do, don't I?
You do, mate. They'll get a chance on Thursday to see our midweek video. And, you're looking the part, mate. I'm sure you get asked this a lot, but I have to do it. How the hell do you end up in Snakes on a Plane?
Fun concept. I'm an avid surfer, and I knew we got to finish filming in Hawaii. And it was a no-brainer. I mean, it was Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
And I was skint. And literally got the phone call when I got back from a fruitless, it wasn't fruitless, but I just didn't get any work for a couple of months. Then when I got back to Australia right before Christmas, I booked the job and popped the champagne. I was off to Canada and, filming with Bolu Cannavale and, Elsa Pataky and some really young people that have gone on to great stuff. And I got to live in Hawaii for a month and surf big waves, and I mean, me and the director Ellis became very close. I went to his daughter's wedding. I got to smoke cigars with Paul Walker and met one of my best mates, Noah Johnson, who was my stunt double in Hawaii, who won the Eddie Aikau, and I basically got family in Hawaii from that trip. And that's good to have in Hawaii when you're a white fella howley surfing out in the waves.
I reckon the film has actually, over the years, it's survived that pop cultural juggernaut. Like, it's actually become, something of a cult classic. I love it. Don't care what people say.
If I had my time, I played Australian, not American, because I would have been funnier and not so nervous. And, I would have stood out more. I would have been funny. I would have been more natural. That's my only kind of regret.
As I mentioned a moment ago, I've done a lot of work with Scarefest in Lexington. A lot of our listeners on this show are from Kentucky, and I believe you've recently shot a film there. What's the film, and what's Kentucky like from an Aussie perspective?
I shot two films in Minnesota. One's called Tuscaloosa, directed by Phil Harder.
Yep.
And it's a book, and it's all about the 60s and the pivotal, time of Vietnam War and Black rights and, it was a really fun little role, just a sheriff. And then I did this really, really crazy film noir kind of no dialogue, really interesting project, which is with a really interesting guy that was mates with Phil, where it's called 3 Day Weekend. And it's quite a thriller, and it actually comes together really well. And there's no dialogue, and that's what I liked about it. Plus, I got to live in Minnesota on the lakes and go fishing and have hot baths, hot saunas on the lakes and eat. They eat apple pie there with cheese. I'm a sucker for it now. I can't have apple pie without. Yeah, they have these sharp cheeses with apple pie, and it actually works. I implore you to try it. It sounds crazy, but I'm a sucker for it now.
I won't knock it till I try it. According to IMDb, which is not always that accurate, Shookum Hills, is that something you're doing?
Oh, yeah. Well, that's in Kentucky, but I filmed my part.
Yeah.
So that director, I forgot I did that. Yeah. There you go. So yes, I have done a film, but I did my part in LA.
Right.
There you go. So Shookum Hills. I did that with the director that I worked with on Chernobyl Diaries.
Excellent. Which I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about Chernobyl Diaries on our Thursday night video, because I want to know about that. But we're pretty much out of time. I'd love to talk to you for much longer to get in depth to some of your filmography, but alas, we are out of time. But mate, cheers for indulging me with this chat. You're a bloody legend, and I hope we can do it again someday.
No problem.
Oh, how good was that, mate? When did Nathan Phillips first appear on your radar?
It's hard to say. I seem to remember him in seeing him in something in TV.
Neighbours, probably.
Maybe like when he was kind of a kid or like very youngish.
Yep.
But the video store I used to work at, one of the or two of the customers, I should say. There were three brothers. The third brother, who wasn't a customer at the video store, was a filmmaker. His name was Mark Gracie, and he made a couple of films. I think there's a couple of them with Nathan in them. Takeaway and You and Your Stupid Mate,
yep.
I think were both
yep.
his films. And we got them in the store because of the, we had to. And I think that's the first time I kind of saw Nathan. Then when Wolf Creek kind of came out, it was like, oh, it's the guy from You and Your Stupid Mate, which could have been, I'm pretty sure that was You and Your Stupid Mate was before Wolf Creek.
Yeah, definitely.
Definitely, yeah.
always thought, I always knew his face as a sort of a teenager because he's on the same age as him, and I'd seen him in Neighbours, and Australian Rules was a movie that really sort of, you know, struck a chord with me. But he was always just that Aussie actor by then.
I always thought of him as, and we mentioned Baywatch earlier in the show, but I always thought of him as Australia's Hobie, like Mitch's son from Baywatch. Yeah. I don't know why, like he played like a grommet, like a character called Grommet in. Like a soap, like where he played a character called Grommet or something like that?
It may have been. He played those type of characters.
But that's who I always thought he was, Australia's Hobie.
So, yeah, and even, look, I even knew him from Warriors of Virtue 2 when I was a kid because, like, you know, I love the Warriors of Virtue, and to know there was a sequel was exciting. But you know what? It was the movie One Perfect Day and then Under the Radar. Those are the two that really sort of cemented him in my mind as Nathan Phillips, that actor. And then, of course, you had Wolf Creek and the Hollywood gigs came along. And I really like him.
The classic film that is Snakes on a Plane.
Snakes on a Plane, that's it. Which is a fun movie.
Like, you know all those simulations we ran? This is one we didn't think of.
But
is that the greatest Samuel L. Jackson impression you've ever heard?
Oh, mate, I think, to coin one of your phrases, it's phenomenal.
It's phenomenal, yeah. It's like I remember on an episode of Parkinson, Michael Caine was a guest, and they asked him to do a Sean Connery impression, and that was about as good as Michael Caine's Sean Connery impression.
One of the great accents of all time, doing the other great accent of all time.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
But anyway, look, thanks to Nathan for taking the time to chat with me. He will be up on our Thursday night video doing some rapid fire with me. So please join us for that one because it's cool. And I do pick his brain on stuff like Snakes on a Plane. And I even ask if he has seen Snakes on a Train, which if you haven't seen Snakes on a Train, what are you doing? See it.
I haven't seen it. I didn't even know Snakes on a Train was a thing. I thought for a second you were talking about Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade.
It's like, need it be said, it's an asylum title.
Oh, God, yeah. Well, it all makes sense now. But, like, how can they?
But it's pretty good.
I mean, Snakes on a Plane was a big budget version of asylum films. It's like they haven't caught the joke.
I know, but tell me that's not a great cash-in title, Snakes on a Train.
All right. It's phenomenal.
Hey guys, it's Adam here from Adam's Just Seen with another Good Movie Monday recommendation. This week, I will be giving you a slice of Nazi goodness that is known as Overlord. Now, ostensibly, this is just Wolfenstein, the movie. Now, we all know how bad video game adaptations are in cinema, but this one is not, you know, a direct adaptation, but it's basically the same premise. And it rocks. It really, really rocks. So in an alternate 1944, we have some paratroopers who land in enemy territory, are decimated, and then they think that they've got this chance to take out this radio tower. Now, what they discover during their mission is not wholly of this world, a little bit supernatural, a little bit gnarly, and very, very gory. Now, that intersection of action film and horror film, war film, it really works here. Julius Avery, the director, has also got like this really punchy sense of action. And I mean, look, all of us are pretty addicted to World War II video games, and this one really captured kind of that immediacy. So it's going into that realm. He's not going for the realism, you know, of like Saving Private Ryan, even though that when violence happens in this movie, it just absolutely hits. I think that another really good element of this movie is some kind of underappreciated actors that get a chance to shine here. Wyatt Russell, son of Kurt Russell, is really good here, and it really makes for a convincing action leading man. And I think that he's mirrored in a really excellent way by our villain here, played by Pilau Aspek, who you might know from Game of Thrones, but he is incredibly slimy here. So yeah, so like, look, if you're looking for kind of like a kick-ass action movie that just goes into overdrive when it does that genre flip, Overlord is the movie for you, so check it out. I'd give this one 4 stars. Really rock solid stuff here, and I'm very interested to see what Julius Avery does as a director next.
Adam Ross, there he is, sticking with the Nazi horror theme. Much appreciated there, mate. And if this show is any indication, there is not a movie that guy does not love. Of course, you know, he's adopted that 5-star mantra, and look, we love it. Even though that was a 4-star film, Overlord, we appreciate it nonetheless, mate. time to give away some free shit. Last week we promised a double pass to the Lunar Drive-In, and the winner is actually no stranger to Monster Fest or Fake Shemp for that matter. He's practically the monster mascot, Simon Harcourt. He shared his story about the drive-in with us on Facebook, and he wrote, and I quote, "My favorite drive-in experience was going to see Rogue with this girl from high school in year 12. Didn't watch the movie, but it was great." So, you know, bless his cotton socks. Congrats to Simon. We'll be in touch with you, mate, to arrange getting those tickets to you. Thanks to the Lunar Drive-In for supporting the show, and we'll have more of their passes to give away on upcoming episodes. But don't forget, at the start of the show, we played a mystery TV spot, and we do have three copies of Blood Vessel to give away. So the first two people that can identify that movie that was being advertised in that TV spot will win a copy of Blood Vessel on Blu-ray, and the third person to chime in will win a copy on DVD. So email your answers to Glenn at fakeshemp.net, and get in quick and good luck. But Ben, we're almost done. Have you been keeping tabs on celebrities over there? Have any of them died since we started recording?
Fingers crossed. I'm hoping they have.
I think we need to employ a celebrity death watcher. Well, anyway, thanks for those celebrities who didn't die. And on that note, if those celebrities that are listening could maybe not die or possibly do it before we record the next show, that would save us a lot of time and trouble.
Yeah. Wednesday is a good day to die. Exactly. Just got to put that out there. Wednesday is a good day to die.
That's a very good James Bond reference. See, you're a professional, mate.
Does that mean I get paid?
When I get paid, you get paid. Okay. Sponsors, we need you. And on that Bond shell, as opposed to Bond shell.
these puns, they just... it's getting worse and worse as the show progresses.
Thank you to Justin Dix and Nathan Phillips for stopping by to chat about Blood Vessel. The movie is now available on Blu-ray and DVD through Umbrella Entertainment. Thank you to Umbrella Entertainment too for supplying those prizes. And again, thanks to Luna for their support. Thanks to Jarrett from Monster Pictures. Thanks to Monster Pictures. Thanks to Guillermo from Screen Realm, Adam from Adam's Just Seen, and the guys from Bonehead Weekly, Joe, Chad, and James. And thanks to you, Ben, another one in the bag. Not long before we can finally record the show face to face at the same desk. That's exciting.
That'll be a thunderball. It was the only James Bond film I could come up with. Like, it's Doctor No's not going to work here. Diamonds Are Forever's not going to work. View to a Kill is not going to work. I need a one-word Bond film. Spectre. No, that'll be a Spectre. That's not going to work either. I had to go with Thunderball.
All right. Well, nicely done. And thanks to every single one of you for enduring this episode. We really appreciate your support. Please keep sharing us across social media. Tell your friends to listen. Keep vying for those prizes. We've got a never-ending supply of prizes here to give away. And don't forget, we do have a special Sean Connery tribute screening tomorrow night on Facebook and YouTube. And I'm sure we have a super fun show lined up for you next week. A sort of change of pace. We're sort of wiping the slate clean. We haven't got any guests. We're going to just have a full episode of Ben and I going mono-e-mono. So I'm looking forward to that one.
You say mono, I say mano. Let's call the whole show off.
We've got a few more to go at least. But to cap off this vampire-ish theme of an episode, I've got a young Nick Cave singing for you here. This one is about vampires. It's called Bats, and it's by The Birthday Party. Have a great week, everyone, and we'll see you next Monday.